So ladies and gentlemen, it is now my pleasure to invite the opening keynote speaker, Charulata Ravikumar. She has a very interesting title. She said, Lakshman, I'm going to call my topic Suicidal Brand Manager. I said, Charu, assisted suicide is illegal in this country. And my office is right across the valley, got a prison, and I have no intention of crossing the road. So she said, hey, calm down. Okay, then nothing to do with assisted suicide. So I started relaxing. Otherwise, you know, I mean, she really, really, you know, scared me to death. So Charu has a wonderful background working for multinational agencies in both in India and in the United Kingdom, based in London, handling large multi-global accounts for the global multinational agencies. And she has a background from communication, digital transformation, and what is most interesting, the company she represents, you know, Razorfish, is not just a digital marketing company, but a digital transformation company. So it is wonderful to have somebody Charulata's stature, who is going to take us through two aspects, the micro level implications of digital technology from a national perspective, and also micro level at the firm level, how you can enable, how you can empower your enterprise marketing capabilities and build brands. Ladies and gentlemen, it's my great pleasure to invite Charulata Ravikumar.
Well, thank you, everybody, and it's so exciting for me to be here. I just want to take an extra minute, more than my presentation. One, to say that I was lying to Lakshman when I said this isn't about aided suicide. It probably would be, because all the thoughts I'm going to share might get some people to just go and jump. But the second would be that, believe it or not, I'm coming back exactly after 8 years, which is when I last met Nimal. And we've been in touch on Facebook, but exactly after 8 years, back to this country, back to exactly the same hotel, but we were in a conference room upstairs in the month of July, and this is like complete deja vu for me to be back here. I'm so excited because that was a different time, this is a different time. Times have changed so much. And just another story on that, and I'll tell you why I feel times have changed so much in Sri Lanka. My husband had come here for a conference, a Unilever conference in Gull, and this was again about maybe 7 years ago or so, or maybe 8 years ago. And I couldn't get in touch with him for an entire week that he was there, right? And this was incredible. I just couldn't because there were no phones. And he comes back and tells me, guess what? There was no network. I didn't believe him. I didn't believe him. But now I know, and at that point, I told him, listen, you're never going back to Sri Lanka, right? There's no way. And today, the only country I think I'm comfortable when he goes for a conference, Sri Lanka, because the only country where the network works. There's absolutely no country in the world where there is network which goes beyond 30 seconds. There are call drops everywhere. So this is one country where things have changed dramatically in those 8 years, really. So when I was asked to talk on this topic, the future of advertising and brand communications, I said, you know, that's suicidal by itself. I mean, brand advertising and communication and all of that from a brand point of view doesn't even exist anymore. That period is over, that phase is over. And yes, I was part of that. I just saved myself from getting suicidal and making that jump, and I moved on to safer havens. So this topic in itself is so flawed, and I said, never mind, let me start from a flawed statement and see where I can take it to, and I'm hoping I'll be able to open your minds to a few things. Right, a few macro situations that have been happening and things that have changed the geopolitical, geocultural, and geosocial dynamics of the world, and the impact of that is being felt in every part of the world, right? So if you look at it, I can't read it there, so I'll read out of here. Technology and political changes are actually bringing people a lot closer on the one hand. But on the other hand, I mean, look at Brexit, that's one example. But look at how political leadership is changing all over the world. It's also starting to look very inward. So on the one hand, the world's coming together, on the other, countries are looking very, very inward all over again. Over the next few years, the West is going to change its approach to the rest of the world, like the East and countries like ours. Why? Because the West will slowly turn back on immigration, outsourcing, and economic integration, because they have started looking inward to make things the markets grow internally. Automation and Chinese overcapacity, just look outside your window, it's all going to happen here, right? So automation and Chinese overcapacity will hit manufacturing and growth in services, and that is going to happen. So traditionally, markets which are traditionally manufacturing are also expanding on both fronts, on services as well. So Sri Lanka, for example, has a contribution of about 56% to its GDP through services, right? And therein lies perhaps a very big strength for this country to really grow. It's perhaps not so much in manufacturing. While I think about 3 or 4 years ago, all the countries were talking about manufacturing, I think today that vision is changing a little bit, right? Because if you look at an airplane today, or a car today, so what really empowers the car? What powers the car? What drives the car? Is it the engine? Is it the software? And those lines are getting blurred dramatically, right? So if it's software that's really touching everything and powering everything in future, then how do you know what really is manufacturing, what really is services? Those lines are getting blurred as well. And I'll come back to why these are relevant to Sri Lanka in a big way. And I have, by the way, I just wanted to say that I have been working in this market while I was based out of London and the Middle East. So every 3 months, I used to be visiting Sri Lanka. So Sri Lanka, Bangladesh, Pakistan, India were markets that I managed out of those countries as well. So I'm very close to this place, and I've been tracking changes happening here. And employment and entrepreneurship will happen through platforms that aggregate farmers, retailers, truckers, and service providers. So the entire value chain is being developed. The entire value chain is getting built up in a very rapid pace. And in silos, these aren't going to work anymore. Right? Benefits of staying connected is becoming really high. Why? Because things are affordable, reliable, and always available. So only in a connected world can really consumers have access to everything when they want, how they want, and where they want it. And I think one of the biggest follies that brand managers often do is they look at consumers as being this animal sitting somewhere out there, which is very different, sitting inside a cage, and you have to study it with research and study to see what's happening and how it's evolving and all that, forgetting completely that it's actually us, right? And the same changes are touching our lives, and we are the ones going through it. So if we behave differently today to what we did 1 year ago, believe me, that's exactly how all consumers are behaving, because we represent that community. The sphere of influence is getting very, very uncontrollable, right? And when you see it in any walk of life, as parents on children, on education, because the influence sphere is very different on children right now, in terms of how brands are getting influenced, consumers are getting influenced, right? If I were to ask you, anyone from a product manufacturing, yeah? Any? Yeah, cool. So I think 3M, right? So you have about thousands and thousands of products. Give me any one product, anyone, just one. Sandpaper, right, sandpaper, okay. Right, so sandpaper is also used in glass to, right, am I correct? Okay, so I'm not from the industry, but I think sandpaper is used to really polish glass and smoothen glass and all of that. So where do you think your competition really comes from today? Sorry? No, I mean from which industry? Sandpaper industry.
Yeah.
No. So here's the folly that, again, you know, you have those suicidal instincts. I've got to talk to you about this after the session. But I think when you look at sandpaper, or I'll give you another analogy, and I'll come back to sandpaper. We were in talks with a cement company. We work with a couple of cement companies. And in one of the sessions, I was telling them, so who's your competitor? They named all the other cement companies as competitors. But if you look around you in construction, cement is getting replaced with glass. Right? And the industry is not even looking at glass as a direct competition, right? Why? Because glass is getting more and more toughened, right? Glass is getting toughened, glass will not be breakable in future. Glass can actually provide transparency that a wall, cement wall can't, and can also provide interactivity. I have another video right at the end. If at some point I have time, I'll play that for you. But today, any glass wall can actually become a very interactive RFID wall. Why would you invest in something like cement? So here goes an entire industry overnight could be thrown out. So sandpaper, for example, if glass as an industry is replaced with something else, a tougher material, which is lighter, easier, cheaper, and it's going to come in. And I'm sure the Chinese are sitting somewhere and experimenting with all this, right? And sandpaper as an industry is going to die because that industry, the ancillary industry, is actually taking shape somewhere else. And that's where we are not connecting dots today to understand where is my real competition today. And I'm looking very myopically at the industry that I'm experimenting with and I'm living with, right? Our own industry, I mean, look at it. I think you'll be able to actually add to this, the advertising and technology industry as well. Look at consultants who came in very quietly as consultants, right, and said, we're just consultants. Today, Deloitte has just announced that they're going to set up, they've already set up a digital space. And McKinsey has just recently announced last week that they're setting up a completely new creative wing for themselves, right? So what happens to advertising and creative agencies when a consultant comes in with a one-stop service offering? So what happened is unbundling, and 8 years ago, I know that we sat in exactly the same hotel talking about why unbundling is going to be the future, right? And today we're talking about bundling is going to be the future, right? So the future today doesn't exist beyond a year. And people today are still scared to look at vision statements which are crafted for endless times for children and children and their children to come. That never changes. We don't even revisit our own vision statements to say how this could be different. So look at how consumers are changing in the same time. So that chart was all about a macro level of what changes can impact our countries. But here at a more customer level, as a consumer level, digital ubiquity, which means digital being everywhere, has changed the world completely. And just like I have seen this change, and I know that I can always be in touch with my husband when he travels here, look at the change that's happened at the Vatican Square. And this is just between 2005 to 2015, where on the one hand, people are using all candles and staying there and standing there. On the other hand, everyone's out. It's not candles, it's mobile phones clicking away, right? That's the big change that's happened in the first place. The second being the new age customer empowerment. The new customers seeking transparency, control in their hands. They're looking at changing times. They're changing so rapidly. Even before you've done your on-ground research with the Nielsens and IMRBs and whoever else in Sri Lanka, they take about 3 months to do their research and come back with another month for their reports. The consumers changed overnight in 2 months. Two days, right? That is the level and rapidity of change that's happening. And are we gearing up for that, right? We probably aren't. So the kind of companies that are really making strides and big strides in future are purpose-built companies, right? So no, and if you've got a product and if you've been in the business for decades, for 30 years, 40 years, holding on to the same products because they've been successes in the past is not going to get you into the future. And these purpose-built companies are keenly eyeing where the consumer trends are going, where life trends are going, where big changes are happening, and how can they play a part in the big change and empower the customer. More messages, more ad avoidance. And I think that's where probably Arthik is going to take you through programmatic, right? Everybody avoids ads. I'm from the industry. I've set up all my ad blocks, right? I don't want ads. I'm human. Just because I'm from the industry, you can't barrage me with ads. Programmatic is really taking over everywhere. It's all getting automated. Automated real-time study of the customer to look at how you can make the shift as the customer is going through their journey and changing from one point to the other. Omnichannel is table stakes right now. There is no option to this. There is no option at all. So if you have just a physical space of selling your products, or you think you have just an online space of selling your products, you're suicidal again. Right? Customer data is everywhere. Every single place, everything is recorded, whatever you do on your phone, any little, I agree that you click on any site, you've just pushed all your data to someone out there. It's all over the place. But people are not using data as much as they should. What's happening really is it's the convergence of creative media and technology, which is really together with data analytics, together with programmatic, automations, AR, VRs, and all of that is really coming together in one convergence. And that's where the organization that can converge all of this very, very seamlessly is going forward to. I was talking to Lakshman about this yesterday, and I said, maybe I won't go through this, but when we were discussing it, and he said, no, I think this is very relevant and sums up a lot of things that I'm talking about. Lakshman, are you going to put up this top card for me just now, or do I have time? I do have time, okay. I don't know if you can read that, neither can I, but I shall try and attempt from here. So 5 big trends that are really going to govern what shapes the changes that an organization needs to be looking out for. The Internet of Me is really happening, right? So IoT and all that is very exciting. But I think people are looking at it very myopically in terms of what is it that the invention that you've created can do. Whereas what the customer is saying is, sorry, it's about the Internet of Me. How can you connect me well to make a change in my life? And that's what they're seeking. So combining data with much faster output. If you can't get things out to me much faster, I will move to somebody else who does, and somebody else will do it. The second being outcome economy. So the intelligent hardware is bridging the physical and digital enterprise. And that's what's happening with the outcome economy. So those two are coming together as well. The digital revolution through automated decisions and cloud mobility is also changing costs. So at a time when countries like ours, even India, and Sri Lanka, and Bangladesh, and you know the South Asian countries, are talking about, we can't afford it. We don't have the capital investments that we need for technology. And that's not true anymore. That barrier of technology not achievable because of high cost doesn't exist anymore, right? Because it's all on cloud and mobility has really enabled the process very well. And innovation does not have to be expensive. We'll just see some examples there later. Super useful brands. I'd like to share some of these thoughts with you. And I think what we've seen more through our research as well, which is a combination of observations online, offline, etc., is that people prefer brands that are super useful to me and to the society. The preference for brands that are actually caring about the society around them is much higher than brands which are just profit-led, right? So apart from doing something good for me, you have to do something good for society. Otherwise, I'm not interested in listening to who you are because I know you're selfish and I don't want a selfish brand talking to me. The last one being the entire workforce being reimagined, right? So in organizations, people are getting replaced, right? What the labor unions fought over years ago and killed many industries, for example, the cotton industry in India, it's inevitable. Automation is going to happen. There is going to be more precision. And while in the short run, robotic shop floor integration is going to be expensive, but in the long run, it is going to find more efficiencies. So people will have to find new jobs. They will not be existent anymore, right? How many people from finance here? Oh, I'm sorry. I was going to say finance as a function led by people may not exist. Oh, that's true for other functions too, so don't worry, you're not the only one. We're all going to be jumping into it. Advertising may not exist, right? Atik is going to eat up all our jobs as well because he's going to go programmatic and say everybody's... Hey, I remember this one line from Victor Hugo's La Miserable. So it's about the bishop scandalsticks. I don't know how many of you have read it. So there's a very nice, interesting line in that. It says, and that was so many years ago. So there's this convict who's discussing with the bishop, and the convict says, now I'm not a name, I'm a number. Right? And that kept coming back to me when I was putting these slides together. We're all numbers now. We're all numbers. Yeah, it's all in a matrix. We're not humans anymore. And I think everything is going to take over that. And where do we as humans exist within that is going to be a struggle we're going to be living with. So hence, this whole premise is very, very suicidal. And therefore, I said, okay, let's talk about the curious case of the brand manager. So if you look at this quick chart out here, this is the problem of technology or mindset is a question that comes to mind, right? Because if you look at it, the 89% their share, I don't know if you can read that, says share of companies anticipating digital disruption. In this room, it'll be 100%, right? That's why you're here. 89% of the companies worldwide, this is a Forrester research recently done, say that they are looking at disruption. But only 32% of the companies, a share of companies able to respond to change, right? So the writing's on the wall or the writing's on the net. And people know it's happening, but they're not gearing up for it. So here's your suicidal attempt number one I thought I should touch upon. And I know I'm going to go a little micro right now, but still not in so much details because the panels and the sessions after this is going to cover a lot of this in detail. I just wanted to open your minds to the thinking as the day unfurls. So the power is in my hands. Brand managers have constantly felt that they are very powerful, right? And I'm sure that was the case for brands like Coke and Pepsi for many years, saying they own the world. I mean, everything, this world is ours, and everybody is drinking a Pepsi or a Coke in some country. This is a Coke country, right? There's a lot more Coke here. But that power has completely shifted. It has totally shifted to the hands of the consumer. And today, you don't have the power to wield the thinking of the consumer, right? So while you're looking at touch points and playing with touch points and looking at how can I put my brand into this touch point and get my customer to like my brand, it's not going to happen. You have to try and change a behavior. And to change that behavior, you have to offer a service, which is super useful. If you're not doing that, the product's not going to do it for you. So a lot of the mass marketing is really moving to a lot of participation-driven customer experience. The customer experience has become a really big thing, but how do we do it? It all sounds great. The customer wants a good experience with your brand, but how do we get them to participate in what we do? Right. I don't have the cue sheets here. But here, the next video I'm going to play is a Unilever video. It was one of the really good attempts of Unilever. Anyone from Levers here? No. So it was a very good attempt by Unilever, where they understood that, look, we cannot tell them, buy a Tresemme, buy Sunsilk, or buy this brand or that brand. People are not listening to us. And why would I not listen to you? Because you are my friend, and I will listen to you. In today's world, the customer is willing to listen to their friends a lot more than brands and corporates, right? The trust factor, which was so important at one time in our research, trust always featured, right? 90% of my customers trust me. No. That 90% is now going to, I trust my friends, I trust my universe of influencers. And this is how we did it, to be able to promote all the brands of Unilever, to say, okay, let's look at the problems customer face. And let's look at how they can generate all the content which tells other people that it works.
The average woman suffers 20 years of bad hair days, leaving her preoccupied and depressed 3 times a week. Every month on Google, there are 1 billion cries for help. Most never get heard. Our idea? Bringing together the biggest search engine, the biggest hair brands, and the world's best YouTubers to banish bad hair days for good. All Things Hair constantly monitors hair searches to see what women are looking for. This is passed to vloggers who, every day, use these searches to create inspiring, brilliant answers using Unilever hair brands. We then buy the trending search terms to point to that content on the All Things Hair YouTube channel, so women can find it just when they need it.
Hello everyone, today I'm going to show you how to recreate this amazing fishtail braid.
There they can browse by hair type, find all the latest hair trends, treatments and how-tos, along with the Unilever products to make it happen.
And then for a little bit more extra condition, I've used this Dove Hair Therapy self-warming hair mask.
Could I get another 5 after that? Is that possible? 10. Is that okay? 10. Yeah, great. Thanks. So I'm going to quickly cut short some of my videos to be able to keep to that time. I also have a quiz, by the way, which is why I need those extra minutes. I have a quiz and I have some things to give away, so I want to make sure you're all paying attention, right? So there'll be 4 quiz points in this presentation. Here's the first one. Domino's. Domino's went through a really big problem, and this also shows, I mean, we faced a problem in our country with Nestle, right? Oh, sorry, Nestle faced a problem in our country. We didn't face a problem. In came Baba Ramdev with all his products at the same time. So we had a problem where Nestle got completely wiped out because of social media. Partly because of social media. Won't get into details. But Domino's actually faced exactly the same problem, and they could have been wiped out. This particular incident of Domino's could have went completely viral. And I want you to tell me, once you look at this, how do you think the company responded? And the reason this is important is, in today's times, you cannot sit back saying, I have a great product, I have great loyalty in customers, customers believe my proposition, my offering. No. Like Nestle, you can get wiped out overnight, 48 hours, right? So let's...
Hello.
This is Michael's special Italian sandwich.
And all the sandwich it goes. Now, Michael, I think that these sandwiches are going to be full of protein.
It's our special ingredient.
Mascara.
KFC's got theirs. Domino's has theirs.
So just raise your hand if anyone wants to answer very quickly. You have to move on fast as to how do you think they responded.
This man went on to do other things.
I had to edit the video. It was really disgusting.
Yeah.
So he did a lot of other things. We'll take all the joy out of Domino's. So what do you think he did? What do you think the company did to save the entire business of Domino's from falling like Domino's? These were the kind of messages that they got. Please fire him. We will never have Domino's again. Shut the business in this country and all of that. So what do you think happened? Very quickly. Anyone? There's a book to be given away. It's a very nice one. Yeah. It's called The Art of Thinking Clearly. And if that's not making you answer this question, then I'll tell you there's a $1,000 bill in this as well, in this envelope. I thought I'll make it really exciting for people to be participative. So I've got a $1,000 bill in this. Now, you want to raise your hands? No. Nobody wants money in this country anymore. Okay. Oh, well. Are they? You won't find this one on Google, actually. I don't think you'll find this as a case study in Google. Yeah, go on. Okay, and? Well, in a way, both are right, okay? But I think you are more right than you are right. So I'll tell you why. I'm not going to play the entire video, but
Hello.
I'll play just a few seconds.
I'm Patrick Doyle, president of Domino's USA. Recently, we discovered a video of two Domino's team members who thought that their acts would be a funny YouTube hoax.
So I'll just narrate this quickly.
Sincerely
this, the president of Domino's USA actually came on and apologized in public.
Quickly alerted
and
us
this,
and
this went virally, acknowledged
action.
That this was a mistake, the person has been fired,
the individuals
and the fact that this is not happening.
Hoax,
now, the key thing here was he's not wearing a suit,
seriously.
He's wearing plain clothes like
this
a Domino's person.
The
logo there, the word principles written behind it, this is all stage. Managed, right? It's very important to send that correct message out to your customer.
The store has been shut
I'll give you the book later. Okay. The second attempt is the 360 degree concept. Okay, we'll build our brands. This is such an outdated concept of 360 degrees. And what you're all going to be doing is 360 degrees means that the customer is getting hammered from all sides on 360 degrees. It doesn't quite work like that because interactions have to move to innovative customer experience. And that's exactly where they're doing this, right? Customer touch points need to be, the touch points are not important. The behavior in those touch points need to be changed, which becomes important.
You don't normally find.
So this, want to quickly play this for you, saying in Audi, what we did for Audi was, Audi came to us with a problem saying that people are not coming to buy our cars in the cities and we don't have the money to really create showrooms in the cities. How do I display 40,000 of my cars? How do I get you to really come and experience those 40,000 cars and then purchase? Because you will not drive all the way outside the city limits, right? You want to be still in the city. So in the heart of London, we started this and now we have 6 of them and another 15 being built all over the world. So here's how interactions are moving to customer experience.
You don't normally find car dealers in city centers. They're usually located in suburban or industrial zones. However, today's customers increasingly live and work in urban areas. Audi's goal, bring the showrooms to where its customers are, the city centers. But how can something as big as a car dealership move into something as small as a boutique on the high street? The solution, digital technologies that enable customers to experience the full range of 48,000 cars. Using multi-touch tables, customers can create their individual configuration and explore every detail and option. With just a single fingertip,
I'm going to move on from this. You get the point here. I can share these videos with you later at some
point.
But this is entirely RFID, and 70% of the cars sold here do not have test drives done. People actually just coming by. And about 70% are non-Audi buyers. That is what Experience is doing. Experience is making you not even try a product, right? In the early days, you would say physical product, touch and feel, and all that is so important. This completely beats that philosophy and that thinking.
In October 2000,
I'm not going to play that video. I'm just going to move on. The third is there's only one way, which is my way, right? And that problem is about siloed channels that we're talking about. Omnichannel and e-commerce are going hand in hand. You can't actually have one without the other, and we talked about that. I'm not playing that video, but it shows, I think you've also done a lot in retail here. I know that brands like Amante are really doing a lot of work in the retail side. Also, I was looking at the site for Dilma. Dilma's, hospitality that they've started, it's called Dilma... Dilma Tales is an excellent way to create that omnichannel feeling. Why? Because it's an experience delivered. You can actually take that to other countries and bring people to experience the Dilma experience, not the tea experience. It's time that Dilma didn't sell teas and sold those experiences, which is what they're doing really well. Right. The last being, I know my threats and I know my customer, which is what we discussed, and I don't want to talk about that too much more because sandpapers, competition, cement's competition, where is it all coming from, etc. Alibaba, for example, has become one of the biggest threats to banking as an industry, right? Because that's really getting very important. Just a quick example on Kotak, and I know that I believe... Sampath Bank is actually taking this forward quite a bit in this country. Kotak was the first one in India to start Twitter-based banking. Right? And that's a big leap forward as Twitter-based banking, which is getting the customers closer to the brand. Eureka Forbes, some of you would know, changed the way it does business. And it had to die. It would have died a quick death. Because in cities like Delhi and Bombay, The AquaGuard salesman who became a part of the family and came into houses couldn't enter these buildings anymore. So they went online completely from offline. And now they're integrating their online and their offline. Our customers love us and will never go away. Complete myth, because they are going away. There are intelligent platforms and automations that is making them go away. Okay. And I'll get out of this. Here's Activision, right? And what happened here was, this is a game, okay? The Nexus platform that we use is being used for this particular game, and if you can tell me which one I'm talking about here. At every point in this game, when you've actually finished your opponent, we notice that the interest of the player wanes down exactly at that point. That is the point, real time, as the interest is waning. And I'm not talking about all together, I'm talking about you. You may go to the next level, you may be dropping down there. Where is the funnel leakage happening? And automation and data science is actually identifying those points and giving you a solution, giving you a little tag to say, okay, here's a little bit more that you can go with. Here's for something for you to go to the next level, etc. So that kind of automation is really taking place as well. Cater to people's overt needs and expressed wishes, okay? Two worlds are merging into one, and that's happening. This is... I don't want to play this video, but what I want to talk to you about is how many of you know about Pokemon and what happened with Pokemon yesterday and day before? Have you seen it? Who knows? If someone knows, gets the book. Can you tell me quickly what happened? Yes, that's right. That's right. They didn't put the dolls all over the world. It's all on your mobile app, right? So the app is merging. Pokemon really has come up with this thing yesterday. They launched it, saying that you can use your app and play with Pokemons wherever you go. It is absolutely wherever you go. And this is very similar to what Google Tango did. So this is a video of Google Tango, which I'm not going to play for you. You can access it on YouTube. This is bringing the virtual world and real world together for you.
That's a one-stop shop.
I'm going to move on and address really how this is all going to be about super useful brands as well. And finally, looking at what does all this mean for you in Sri Lanka, right? Adding value and being super useful.
This is a story about a shirt that could change your...
Okay. Two videos only to be played and then my last slide. Is that okay? Just a minute more.
O tratamento desse tipo de doença, ele é um tratamento bastante longo, ele é um tratamento que priva a criança de uma série de coisas, essa criança tem que ficar muito tempo internada, ela tem inúmeros efeitos colaterais e, portanto, afastada da rotina habitual dela, da escola, dos amigos.
Demorou?
Por que chama mesmo?
Francisco, Chico.
O professor.
Que professor é?
Professor dá aula pra gente.
Da minha tia, da minha avó.
Just moving out of this quickly, what this does is actually brings families closer for cancer patient children. And the children feel that the family is talking to them. It's voice-based, converting it to the message real-time to the child in the hospital. Simple technology. It exists here in this country. Imagine what you can do with healthcare with the technology you already have. You don't need to import anything else, right?
Então vamos lá, um, dois, três e...
Okay. Just to sum it up, and my last thought is, there's a 19 trillion economy really out there because of the digital changes that are happening all over the world, right? So what does that mean for Sri Lanka? Oh, can you just tell me what is Sri Lanka's market size very quickly? Who can tell me Sri Lanka's market size? No, I think there's something wrong with the slide, but... No, the market size, the overall consumer base in Sri Lanka. Quickly, because I have to end my slide, otherwise he won't let me stay on stage anymore, and you don't get the book. 21 million? 21 million? It's actually 1.7 billion, right? Because I think what Sri Lanka needs to do is stop looking inward as if you're an island, right? You will not find the joy in selling to 21 million people. No way with India and China as neighbors, right? Everybody's going to be interested in those markets because the numbers are big. I think you have to reverse this trend. Reverse the trend by looking at 1.7 billion as a rough estimation of the countries surrounding you and where consumerism is really growing, okay? And these technologies also already exist there. You don't need to create the technologies. It exists. What you need to create is a change in your mindset. And I was identifying four really big areas that you can take to the rest of the world. Business tourism, because with the kind of internet connectivity that you have, this is going to be the ideal place for business tourism. Hospitality, nothing like this country. Everybody wants to come here. You have an amazing island. Everybody wants to be here. It's service-oriented. Fashion, I mean, Amanthe today, and I know I've actually met some of the Amanthe people in the past, and I know that today they're catering to some of the global brands, designing the brands here, and actually taking some of these designs to the global markets, right? Can you bring some innovation in the fabric in this country, which can be absolutely unique? Check out Ably as a t-shirt. They've just come up from Seattle. And this is a t-shirt that you don't have to wash for about 4 weeks and take it on holiday. Imagine how it changes travel, because it absorbs everything and it wards off all liquids. It wards off dust and all of that. I'm getting myself one next week. And finally, tea and what Dilma has done to it. Any product cannot remain as a product, but must deliver itself as an experience. And I think what Dilma has done to the rest of the world. But the only problem, they have not populated this to the world. The world doesn't know that something as exciting as Dilma's customer experience exists really here. So the future of Sri Lanka is really in your hands. Get away from the island mindset. The world is your market both ways, right? Internally, externally. Export what you can from here and bring in what you can in terms of talent. Focus on core industries. Create unique customer experiences that the world will talk about. And reimagine, innovate, and disrupt global markets on thinking. And with that, thank you very much. And take yourself to the future. Yeah.